All right, 1 Corinthians chapter 2, welcome to the internet. Look with me in verse 9. We're going to talk about the spirit of the world and how it works. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 9, "But as it is written, eye hath not seen nor ear heard, neither hath entered into the heart of man the things which God hath prepared for them that love him. But God hath revealed them unto us by his Spirit, for the Spirit searcheth all things, yea, the deep things of God. For what man knoweth the things of a man save the spirit of man which is in him? Even so the things of God knoweth no man but the Spirit of God. Now we have received not the spirit of the world." So there is a spirit that can be received, and it's the spirit of the world. "But the spirit which is of God, that we might know the things that are freely given to us of God." Obviously then, turn with me to 2 Corinthians chapter 4. And observe what he's saying here in 2 Corinthians chapter 4. About 90% or more of people, if you read this verse to them, if you ask them who this God is that they're talking about, will say it's God Almighty. But in 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 3, "But if our gospel be hid..." Now that will not happen from God Almighty. It's the will of God for all men to be saved and come to the knowledge of the truth. So he's not hiding the gospel. Just the opposite, he revealed the gospel to the Apostle Paul. "So if our gospel be his, hid to them they're lost." Now why? "In whom," the lost, "the God of this world hath blinded the minds of them which believe not, lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine unto them." And the reason he's blinded them is to keep that glorious gospel of Christ to shine unto them. So he uses ministers and obviously his sanctuaries, which we might read in a minute in Ezekiel. But if he's the God of this world, then obviously it is that spirit that he indwells in people. Now look in Matthew chapter 4. In Matthew 4. Verse 1. Now, this is a specific story by one leadership to go against another. All right, Matthew 4:1. "Then was Jesus led up of the Spirit," and that's a capital S in my Bible. I don't know what you have, but that's supposed to be a capital S. And that's "the Spirit of the Lord led him into the wilderness to be tempted of the devil," that's the small d. Okay, so the specific leadership here led him up to be tempted of the devil, where part of the Word of God, which says tempted in all points like as we are, yet knew no sin, this is the basis of some of those temptations here. Verse 2, "And when he had fasted 40 days and 40 nights, he was afterward hungered. And when the tempter came to him," so we learn that the devil is the tempter. We learn in Revelation 20 Revelation chapter 20, after the 7 years of tribulation, the devil is put away for 1,000 years to tempt the nations no more. So we know the tempter. We also know that in 1 Corinthians, hold here just a minute, 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 13, he said, "There hath no temptation taken you, but such as is common to man. But God is faithful, who will not suffer you be tempted above that you're able, but will with the temptation also make a way to escape, that you may be able to bear it." And the bear is, in other words, bear against it, not succumb to it. Now, if you go back and read the thing, it's about idolatry in the Old Testament in the wilderness. And look in verse 7, "Neither be ye idolaters, as was some of them, as is written, the people sat down to eat and drink and rose up to play. Neither let us commit fornication, as some of them committed, and fell in one day 23,000. That's a pretty good herd, ain't it? "Neither let us tempt Christ, as some of them also tempted and were destroyed of the serpent." So he gives you two different things involved there, where people tempted and were tempted to do this, And no doubt there was a spirit leading them doing that kind of thing. Now go back again to Matthew 4, where this temptation is going on. We understand if he's the God of this world, he has the power of this world. Now Jesus has all power given unto him in heaven and earth, but just as he has power, he also allows things to happen in grace. Grace has to be something to where it is strictly by grace. Thus, you will be tempted, you will have adversaries, you will have possibilities. You have to trust the Lord to make a way. And sometimes that takes a while because we're not on his time, we're not on his ways, and we're not on his thoughts. So we have to step back and trust the Lord, and he will make a way to escape, okay? It's great that he will not have you tempted above your able, but to also make a way to escape, a lot of us don't want to escape. We want to go ahead and take it. But when we take it, then when things go wrong, we want to blame God. It wasn't God that caused it. It was God that allowed it for you, basically in your earning of reward and loving God, to show you believe that he is able. That's the problem with most people, is they won't let God show his ability in their life. Now, Matthew 4:3. And when the tempter came to him. Now, if he's been hungry for 40 days, what's the first thing you're going to tempt him with?
Food.
Okay? This teaching here coincides with them. Are they to sell out?
Yes.
Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Then will they have to have the Lord supply their need?
Yes.
The prayer of Matthew 6, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. So are they asking in vain or are they asking in need? Okay, so that coincides with the tempter would make a way for them not to believe in God and not to trust in God in the tribulation. If you don't take his mark, you don't eat. Now, I'm not talking about you. I'm talking about the doctrine of the people in the tribulation. If they don't take the mark, they don't eat. But if they don't take the mark and trust the Lord, will he supply their need? All right, had the people in Acts 2, 3, 4, 5 sold out? Did they do the apostles' doctrine? Yes. All right, once you sell out, what are you going to sell out again? So if the funds in the kitty run low, who's going to have to supply the need? Okay. Why did Ananias and Sapphira hold back money? And they died for it. They held it back for their belly. Folks, why do you work? First thing, I know you, Georgia. Don't doubt about that. You're first in line on Sunday. No. Your belly is your number one concern. Your belly even goes over your clothing. You know, I'm not going to do that. If they will not take the mark, then they must trust the Lord, right? In Acts, they sold out. When their kitty ran low, what had God done to take care of them? He saved Paul. And Paul and his ministry, they took up bounty to feed the starving saints at Jerusalem. A lot of people take the early ministry of Paul and try to apply it today. I don't really know who we would feed in the church of God because they probably don't exist. But I can tell you one thing. It is not wrong to supply the need of people that are hurting because we are not told to sell out. We can supply the need of other people. And that's like Don and I was reading a verse in Herald. You look to another man's wealth, not take it from him, but to help him when he's down and out. Especially a brother. He said, if any provide not for his own, especially those of his own household, he's denied the faith and is worse than an infidel. So, I mean, there's rules and regulations in Paul's But it's not based on whether you'll have eternal life. It's based on the fact that the love of Christ constraineth us in that sense. And that we are willing to, and we know that our Almighty God will give us account, fruit to our account when we do it. So if you gave the bill, that fruit went to your account. If you did it cheerfully, more the better. If they couldn't hardly pull it out of your hand, then, you know, you might have to answer for that. But cheerfulness is what God loves. Well, in this sense, the Lord's got to be hungry, doesn't he? Can you imagine this crowd going 40 days without eating? We'd have chewed each other's arms off and been eating the shoes and the boots and everything else. He went 40 days. What was he doing during that 40 days, you think? He's praying to the Father. I mean, you pray 5 minutes and you'll go to sleep. He spent 40 days talking to the Father about things. And I'm sure the conversation between him and the Father was amazing. Just, totally amazing. We can't even imagine it. So he said, when the tempter came to him, he said, if thou be the Son of God, command that these stones be made bread. Okay, does Jesus know that God will feed him? Then why does he need to make stones? Why does he make stones bread? Who's telling him to do that? Okay. But he answered and said, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth forth out of the mouth of God. What is the context they're talking about? Are they talking about food and eating? Yes. Then what will the word of God do for him? It will feed him. And I'm talking about not only spiritually, but in the Word of God, it will tell him he'll take care of him. Are you with me? God's Word tells you that he can do exceedingly above all that we ask or think. God is able to make all grace abound towards you, that you having all sufficiency in all things may abound to every good work. You see where you doubt? Come on, shake your head yes or no, or throw something at Brother Jerry. God said he would. It's in the Word of God. And Jesus himself said, it's written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth forth out of the mouth of God. He did not say, man shall not live by bread. It said, alone. Let's check something out. Turn to 1 Timothy chapter 6. How many like your paycheck? Well, I hate to say it that way because most people don't like their paycheck. But how many like your paycheck because you can buy food? Okay? This has been quoted in and out, but they'd never, sometimes they miss it a little bit. 1 Timothy 6:10. For the love of money is the root of all evil, not money. Do you need money to live? Oh, absolutely. But the guilt that's put on people in the preaching today is that if you don't give 10, you won't get 1,000 or 100 from God, and on and on. That is not the basis of the giving in the first place. But it's the love of money is the root of all evil. Not money. The world is set up on money. Barter, trade, whether it was paper money or a trading soap or whatever else, it's that type of thing that would bring something in. It's the love of money is the root of all evil, which some coveted after they have erred from the faith and pierced them through with the many sorrows. So I go back to Matthew 4 with the Lord. Was the Lord a lover of money? No. And when Peter came to him and confronted him with the fact that he was going to have to pay taxes, he said, what I got to pay taxes for? But since you said it, go catch that fish. Wouldn't you love to catch some of them fish? And he brought back a coin. And he said, whose inscription is that on that? And he said, well, it's Caesar. He said, well, pay Caesar's due with it. See what I'm saying? And by the way, you hate the IRS, don't you? But you're subject to Romans 13. So you pay it and gripe about it. Don't pay it and you're going against the Lord. They asked me when I started preaching, you want to take a thing to where you don't have to pay tax being a preacher. And I said, nope. And I didn't. I file taxes every year because I'm a citizen. I don't like it. But you know what? I'm subject to it by God, not by them. I'm not subject to them. I'm subject to God, them through God. He allowed it, didn't he? Did God allow everything? Then as I go through my life, I'm going to trust him if he allowed it to take care of it. Boy, if you don't think your God don't know, then you got a little bit of training to do, folks. If you think God's been fooled by all this, and if you think God's been fooled by the election or 8 years ago or 20 years ago or 100 years, you're wrong. He knows what's going on. That's not the problem. The problem is it didn't go our way or it went our way or this way or whatever. We are so trained that we don't get our way, it must not be right. Well, it's God's way, however it works. And he lets the God of this world. My God, folks, what did he do to Jesus in verse 1? What did he do to him? He led him up there to be tempted. Then he's going to tempt you to allow it to happen. But there will be nothing that he will let it go beyond endurance if we take the way to escape. Okay? And by the way, do you think God would make a bad way to escape? No. All right, so verse 5. Then the devil take him up into the holy city and set him upon the pinnacle of the temple. Okay? He's put him in a position that the only way to get down is jump. Can he be delivered? I'm just asking you, can he be delivered from sitting on the temple, the pinnacle? Did you know that God used the devil to move him? He did. Watch, let's read. Then the devil take him up into the holy city and set him on the pinnacle of the temple. And he said, if thou be the Son of God, cast thyself down, for it is written, he shall give his angels charge concerning thee. Now, who allowed the devil to put him there? Then who can move him to get him down? Isn't that amazing? And the Lord waited. And what did he say? Verse 7, Jesus said to him, it is written, thou shalt not tempt the Lord thy God. Why is he talking about tempting the Lord thy God if the devil did it? Trying to make your own way. My ways are not your ways. Then if I try to make my way, it's not his way. Am I making any sense, folks? Watch. It is written, thou shalt not tempt the Lord thy God. Again, the devil take him up into exceeding high mountain. Well, then what did he do on the pinnacle? The devil took him off the pinnacle because he couldn't get him to jump. I'm missing you. He couldn't get him to jump. The devil puts you in a situation. Say, yeah, it'll be all right. Take care of this. The Lord will take care of me. And all the time he's wanting you to jump out of the path. Trust in the Lord with all thy ways, and in all thy ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct thy paths. Pass. Trust in the Lord with all thine heart. Now, what's the matter with your heart? Deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Okay. What is 90% or more of prayers from? The heart speaking out. What if you don't speak aloud? Isn't it funny that I never hear these jokers talk about this, that God Almighty said, go in your closet and pray in secret. If you pray in secret, and then later God does what he said he's going to do in the first place, you reap the benefits of faith. because you know that nobody knew it but God. And that's a blessing, folks. Pray it out loud, and the God of this world, he's glad to answer. He's the God of this world. Now watch. Verse 9, and he said, all these things will I give you. Then what does he have? It says all, don't it? He's the God of this world. Are you listening, folks? Do you think the weather's kind of strange sometimes? Well, there's a reason. Turn with me to Luke 8. That's I had a brain seizure here. Luke 8. I know about the harps. There's 40 harps in the world that control weather. Somebody said that's a lie. Well, let's see. Luke 8. How much knowledge does the God of this world have? He had no knowledge. There's one thing he had no knowledge of, and we'll go into that in just a minute. But the rest of it, he knows. He's heard it. He's read it. What, you think he hadn't read a Bible? Luke 8. Verse 22, now it came to pass on a certain day that he went into a ship with his disciples. And he said unto them, let us go over unto the other side of the lake. And they launched forth. But as they sailed, he fell asleep. I guess he trusts what's ever going on, right? Correct? Yes or no? It's like my wife said one time, I told her, man, I'm sleepy. She said, you want me to drive? I said, I'm sleepy, not stupid. And I was just kidding. I sleep with my wife driving. Hey, I trust her. I mean, why would she want to go out and kill us both? If he got killed, I wouldn't know the difference anyway, would I? Folks, if you die, you don't know the difference anyway, do you? You fear death, and that's the one thing. It ain't going to matter, because if you close your eyes, you ain't going to know the difference anyway. So, verse 23, and as they sailed, he fell asleep, and there came down a storm of wind on the lake. I wonder where that came from. Why, of course. Somebody say, how you prove that? Well, let's just prove it. And they were filled with water, and they were in jeopardy. Who? The apostles and a Lord that was asleep. You telling me that God didn't know that was coming? Now watch. And they came to him and woke him. I'm not sure I'd want to wake the Lord. You ever think about that? What are they demonstrating? Doubt, fear, lack of faith. Come on, folks. If you're in a ship and the Lord's asleep in there, is it a pretty good thing you'll be all right? If you're in the body of Christ, isn't it a pretty good, sure thing you're going to be all right one way or another? Now watch. He said, they came, woke him, saying, Master, Master, we perish. Huh? I can just see my dog over there right now. He's shaking and huffing and puffing because of the thunder. If lightning hits you, hope it hits you on the top of the head and you die and go to the Lord. Otherwise, your guts are fried and it won't matter. Center in on something in thought, folks. If you're saved, God's got you either way. If God is able to do exceedingly above all that he asks or think, that's okay. He can make all grace abound to it. That's great. We know that if earth and the house of this tabernacle were dissolved, we have a house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. That's okay. But Lord, I'm nervous about my funds. I'm nervous about my life. I'm nervous about that. That's the devil working on you. Trying to get you to doubt Almighty God. And watch. Then he arose and what? Are you telling me he rebuked God's wind? There you go. Why, he wouldn't rebuke God Almighty's wind. That's right. He allowed it. And he got up and showed them something. Was it a sign to them? Like a man wake up in the ship and you got a storm coming and he said, peace, be quiet, and it's gone. I tell you what. I'd have a little faith in that feller, wouldn't you? Yes or no? The Lord told Paul, he said, I've appeared for you for this purpose. Paul said, I delivered unto you, first of all, that which I also received. How that Christ died for our sins, according to Scripture. Would you have ever got Paul to doubt any more that Christ died for his sins? Well, then if he died for his sins and God said it's yours, then if he died for your sins, you need not doubt that he died for your sins. Amen. He was buried, and he rose again the third day, and then you got Paul to explain everything, every feature, and every facet of that gospel, in that he was delivered for our offenses and raised again for our justification, so we're justified. He raised again for our glorification, where we've been raised and seated and placed above all principalities and powers, which we'll get into. So did the Lord come up out of his sleep because the doubting disciples woke him up? He got up there and he rebuked the wind in front of them to let them know he had that power. And in that rebuke, they ceased and were calm, the waves, the storm. God, folks, you'd love to see that, wouldn't you? Wouldn't you? Wouldn't you love to be just standing there and a tornado coming at you and a guy says, it'll be okay. I mean, it's coming at you. It's a class 4. Just coming roaring at you. And he said, it'll be okay. And he goes, no, no, no. And you go, hello. I'm trying to get you to think, folks, when you doubt, you're not looking at what is written. Every time the Lord did it, it's written down. Now, look with me in back in Matthew 4. Now, there's one thing you can put in the bank. The God's world wants worship. That means he has worship services. He had sanctuaries, but he defiled them. Boy, that's a curious study right there. Thou hast defiled thy sanctuaries. And watch this, Matthew 4, verse 9. And he said, all these things will I give thee if. What's the condition? If. He won't give them to you if you don't. Hello, hello, hello. Wake up. He won't give them to you if you don't. Does that tell you it's about positions in the world? Why do grace preachers live on fried rabbit tracks and fresh air versus these big ministries? Folks, it ain't nothing for these ministers to make $100,000 above every year. $100,000. More than the people that are sitting in there, except for the chosen few that give it. Why is that? Why would God make his ministers live on almost nothing versus these guys living on a bunch? Why is that? If thou wilt fall down and worship me, I'll give all these things to you. If. What was Timothy told to do? Flee those things. Back to 1 Timothy 6. I buy a lotto ticket, and the Lord said, why'd you buy that? God, this world's not going to give you that lotto ticket. You won't fall down and worship him. Say, Lord, you know I want to give it away. The Lord said, you're a liar. It's true. Is it not? I bought a lotto ticket. The other day, got two numbers. Kathy's first two numbers. I got it, and she's going. And I seen it in there. And I said, oh, my. Watch. Verse 11. But thou, O man of God, flee these things. Flee them. What'd he call Timothy?
Man of God.
Then Timothy's not bowing down and worshiping the devil, is he? Well, thou, man of God, flee these things and follow after righteousness, godliness, faith, love, patience, meekness. Fight the good fight of faith. Lay hold on eternal life whereupon thou art also called and hast professed a good profession before many witnesses. I charge thee in the sight of God who quickeneth all things and before Jesus Christ who before Pontius Pilate witnessed a good confession that thou keep this commandment without spot, unrebukable until the appearing of our Lord Jesus Christ. Verse 17. There's nothing wrong with being rich in the world if you know how to use it. Why? What does it say? Charge them that are rich in this world that they be not high-minded nor trust in uncertain riches, but in the living God. Do you know what those uncertain riches are? That's a big lump of money coming that you didn't earn. It'll ruin you. How many of you remember the millionaire years and years ago on TV? The guy would go to each door every week and give $1 million and watch people what would happen to them. And I mean, they would get in a world of hurt. Because you say, well, $1 million. Back then, when I was growing up, $1 million, they wasn't that many millionaires in the world. That was a lot of money. If gas was 23 cents a gallon, bread maybe 10 to 15 cents, or milk 50 cents or whatever, $1 million was a bunch of money. I mean, you could buy a brand new car for $600. I was in the Harley shop in Arkansas. New Harleys are $40,000. Trucks are $60,000. You farmers got a hurrah. You better keep holding your old vehicles and keep them up, because I'm telling you, man. And it ain't going up with it, is it? Your salary don't go up with that to match that. Inflation's so bad and so high, the money means nothing, folks. A dollar bill means absolutely nothing. You go to a restaurant, figure on $40 to $60 for two people for a meal. Why is everybody working? Because they got to work to eat. And on and on. Somebody told me the other day, he said, Brother Jerry, this year has been really rough on me. I said, if you think it's rough on you, then look at me. Because I'm the first on the food chain that gets cut off. I know this. I've been experiencing that for over 30-something years. You know what? God is able. And if I can in any way at all show you that through me, it gives you some confidence. Faith to faith. It'll be all right. God is able. God does not lie. God cannot lie. Not only does he not lie, he cannot lie. He is righteousness. So if you trust him, it may not go the way you want, but it'll go the way you need. It may not go the way you think it should go, but it'll go according to his purpose. Now, look with me in Romans chapter 1. Now, what do you want the Lord to do? If thou will fall down, I will give you all that. Isn't that amazing? The creature was offering the creator something. I hear people doing that all the time. So, Lord, I'll give you this if you'll do this. What if he don't want to? Romans chapter 1, verse 15, so as much as in me is, I'm ready to preach the gospel to you that are Rome also. For I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it, the gospel of Christ, is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first and also the Greek. Now watch, verse 24. Wherefore God also gave them up to uncleanness through the lust of their own hearts, to dishonor their own bodies between themselves, who changed the truth of God into a lie and worshiped and served the what? The creature more than the Creator, who is blessed forever. Amen. Turn to Ezekiel 28. The book of Ezekiel, chapter 28. All right, in Ezekiel 28, verse 13, thou hast been in Eden, the garden of God. I mean, what was in the garden? Who? Adam. Then Eve was put in there with Adam. Obviously, there's animals in there. And by the way, I've always thought about this. Could they get out of the garden and go somewhere else? He didn't put the cherub there until after they would try to get back in. Right? I mean, they could go anywhere they wanted, but the garden was a great place to live. And so I don't know whether they could go out into the world. That's between God and His Word. I don't know, but obviously, once they're kicked out of the garden, He puts the anointed cherub, flame of fire, not the anointed cherub, but the flame of fire, the cherubims, to keep them from coming back in, because there's a tree in there that they cannot have. Once they take their choice, once they take the choice of that tree, the triune knowledge of good and evil, then this other tree becomes not available to them. God does not want them to take this tree and live like that forever. Correct? And those trees are theirs, the tree of knowledge, good and evil, tree of life. Well, what if they take the tree of knowledge, good, and run real quick over here and get the tree of life? That ain't going to happen. God ain't going to allow it to happen, okay? So in verse 13, thou hast been in Eden, the garden of God. All right, Adam, Eve, God walked in the cool of the day. Who else? The serpent, right? We know him in Revelation 20. His name is the serpent. He's called the devil, okay? Every precious stone was thy covering. He is an individual of beauty. But when was he an individual of beauty? Look with me in verse 15. Thou wast perfect in thy ways from the day that thou was what?
Created.
He's the creature. And he desires worship. And he said, if thou will fall down and worship me, I will give you all these things. Why would the Lord do it? He owns it. Hello. Are you adopted sons of God? Heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ? Then trust him. He will take care of you no matter what. It didn't say anything about not suffering. Folks, it's a miserable thing for me to go into a hospital and not be able to lay my hands on people and let them get well. Why, do you think I like to see Mrs. Friday limping? That's not funny to me. I call her Flash, but it's not funny to me. I'd love to be able to lay hands on that lovely lady and let her be healed. I can't. It's not in this dispensation. And I'm going to trust the Lord, and I'm not going to tempt the Lord to demand it. Well, you hear these guys praying, they demand God do this and cast that devil out. Well, just dream on. And you know when it don't work, the God of this world got what he wanted? Because then they doubt. Isn't it all about doubting? Isn't that what it's all about, folks? To get you to doubt God and his ability. So he was created, right? If you look down here, verse 17, thine heart was filled up because of thy beauty. Was he a beautiful creature? Thou hast corrupted thy wisdom by reason of thy brightness. I will cast thee to the ground. I will lay thee before kings that they may behold thee. Thou hast defiled, what does it say? The places he was at, he defiled them. He defiles every one of them. Guess what? Romans 5. When God created the world and created Adam and Eve, guess what was not in them? The Spirit, the God of this world. Romans 5:12, wherefore is by one man sin entered the world that God created. God, why did you let the devil get in there? Turn to Ephesians. Ain't no use of being in a hurry. You'll get wet if you go out there. In Ephesians chapter 1. Verse 6, to the praise of the glory of his grace, wherein he hath made us accepted in the beloved, in whom we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins, according to the riches of his grace. Back to verse 3, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who hath blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ. Them heavenly places are not defiled, folks. There is a defilement in the second heaven and earth, which we know to be the kingdom of heaven, which would be the first heaven, second heaven stars, third heaven where God is, height of heaven. Where did he bless you? In heavenly places. According, he had chosen us in him when? Before sin entered in. You with me? Before sin entered the world. God had you. Now, why do you reckon he let the devil do what he did? Because you're going to be a person that does not have to see him to believe him. Doubting Thomas said he came the first, wasn't there the first trip when the Lord came into the room and they saw his hands and they saw his feet and his side. And Thomas wasn't there, so 8 days later, the Lord came in again into a room locked because he no longer is flesh and blood. He's flesh and bone. He's that side of the Adam connection, you know, the atoms of the world that God made that can be part of anything. You can't do that with blood, folks. Flesh and blood can't inherit the kingdom of God. The kingdom of God is a spiritual kingdom, but it can have flesh and bone. So he came in, and Thomas was looking at him. He said, you're the one that doubted here. Look here. Just put your finger in there and put your hand in there. No need. I saw it. He said, blessed are those that haven't. You ever tried to explain God or Jesus Christ to an unbeliever? And they laugh at you, and they mock you, and they make fun of it, you know, all that. Do what you want. Die and go to hell. I remember Brother Moore standing there one time, and a guy said, I don't believe in hell. And he said, well, just go to hell then. And he got mad. And he said, what are you mad at me? And he said, you told me to go to hell. And he said, you don't believe in it. Don't worry about it. And the guy looked at him. Whatever. I was in Pensacola. I remember that at Roslyn. You know, you try. You can't prove this book to anybody if they don't want to believe it. You ain't never seen God. You ain't never felt God. You ain't never heard God. You ain't never seen Jesus or touched Jesus. I believe he's there. I believe he is the creator, and his name is God. There's people that argue with you. I don't believe in God. I believe in the creator. Well, ain't you something? What kind of attitude is that? God is the creator. That's what the name God is so demonstrative to say God. I mean, there's no other word under heaven like God. I mean, when you say that, that has some power, that God. But yet he magnified his word above his name. Isn't that amazing? How little stock people put in this. How little time people give this, and it's God speaking to you and telling you, he'll be all right, my son. Don't you understand? Jesus knew in the temptation, it'll be all right, my son. On the cross, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? It'll be all right, son. Father, into thy hands I commend my spirit. And he gave up the ghost. As he went into hell, it'll be all right, son. Thou will not suffer thee to see corruption. It'll be all right, son. You're coming up. Romans 8. Am I doing something wrong? It's awful quiet in here. Romans 8. We didn't come to have fun. We came to think. Romans 8. The great blessing of a believer. Romans 8:15. For you have not received the spirit of bondage. What does bondage cause? Fear. How am I going to get out of this? How's this going to work out? You've not received the spirit of bondage again to fear, but you have received the spirit of adoption, whereby we cry, what? The Spirit itself beareth witness with our spirit that we are the children of God, and if children and heirs, heirs of God, and joint heirs with Christ, if so be that we suffer with him, that we may be also glorified together. Romans 8, verse 31. What shall we say to these things? If God be for us, who can be against us? He that spared not his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? Amen. Who shall lay anything to the charge of God's elect? It is God that justifieth. He's telling you that there are going to be people that try. They're called adversaries. Verse 34, who is he that condemneth? It is Christ that died, yea, rather, that is risen again, who is even at the right hand of God, who also maketh intercession for us. Who? Who? Not what? Who? Shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine, nakedness, peril or sword? As it is written, for thy sake we are killed all the day long. We are counted as sheep for the slaughter. Nay, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him that loved us. For I am persuaded that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus. Look in 1 Corinthians 15. My goodness, is that not a mouthful? 1 Corinthians 15. There are people that have no idea that's in the Bible and have no idea about eternal security and are always walking in doubt, always walking in fear that if they don't do this, they don't toe the line, they won't make it with God. They have no idea that they're absolutely adopted if they want to be and that they have the right to cry, Abba, Father, in times of need. They don't know what to pray for as they ought, but the Spirit itself maketh intercession for with groanings which cannot be uttered for us. All of those things they miss out, and they are always walking in fear. Why? Because the stinking preachers won't tell them. They have bowed down and are worshiping someone else. 1 Corinthians 15, 55. O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, which giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my beloved brethren, be ye steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, for as much as you know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. Ephesians chapter 2. Verse 8, for by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, a gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. And if you're saved by grace, you'll be kept by grace. Then verse 10, for we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which God hath before ordained that we should walk in them. give him the credit, give him the glory. Look in verse 13 of chapter 1. In whom you also trusted, after you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, in whom also after you believed, you were sealed with that Holy Spirit of promise, which is the earnest of our inheritance, until the redemption, the purchased possession, unto the praise of his glory. Ephesians chapter 4, look with me in verse 30. Ephesians 4, 30. And grieve not the Holy Spirit of God, whereby you are sealed unto the day of redemption. Let all bitterness, wrath, anger, clamor, and evil speaking be put away from you with all malice. And be ye kind one to another, tenderhearted, forgiving one another, even as God for Christ's sake hath forgiven you. And a man in the Bible study Thursday night in Pencil Bluff had tried to kill himself. He put a gun right here, and it went up wrong and blew his nose off. Now he's got to go through major surgeries to get it right again. He's a young man. And one of the things he said at the first of the class was, he said, God won't forgive me for that, will you? And I said, you're already forgiven. And I showed it to him. And at the end of the class, I walked to him and I said, son, are you forgiven? He said, I'm forgiven. He saw it. Because one of the teachings is the unpardonable sin is suicide. There's no unpardonable sin, folks. Christ died for our sins and was raised again. And when he did, he was justifying us. And we're justified and forgiven. And there's no better message than that. For we are his sons, adopted heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ. And nothing can separate us from the love of God which is in Christ Jesus. Amen. Appreciate you being here. Be quiet now.